coming up on Theater Talk.
Suddenly I'm in the cockpit. Suddenly I've got my wings. Suddenly all of those pilots protesting me. Well, they can get their own drinks.
Theater Talk is made possible in part by the CUNY TV Foundation.
It all starts with this moment. Remember this.
From New York City, this is Theater Talk. I'm Susan Haskins.
And I'm Michael Riedel of the New York Post.
Michael, we are delighted to be welcoming back to Theater Talk Pulitzer Prize-winning playwright Paula Vogel.
Do you ever get tired of hearing Pulitzer Prize-winning playwright Paula Vogel?
I was thinking I have to rob a bank so we can add bank robber Paula Vogel to it.
That's good.
Yeah.
Pulitzer Prize-winning bank robber Paula Vogel.
Yeah.
And incendiary playwright, yes, an incendiary playwright.
A wonderful playwright.
I love that.
Whose latest work, Indecent, is at the Court Theater.
Yeah, and I remember, we're dating ourselves here, Paula, but I think I was at a very early preview of the Baltimore Waltz.
Wow.
Fine play at,
yes,
Circle Rep back in like 90.
That was 92.
92.
Yeah, with Cherry Jones.
With Cherry Jones.
Joe Mantello. And
Joe directed. That was one of the first.
And Bogart directed it. Joe was acting in it.
That's right, Mike.
And after that, went on to Angels in America. And a wonderful actor, Richard Thompson.
Oh, sure, of course.
So, yeah, that sweet little space.
I know. It's gone now. It was a hamburger joint. Now I think it's a fancy eatery.
Here's the great thing about New York. You know, we started working on it. We worked at it on it at the Sundance, mm-hmm, Theater Lab, which was great. Started in New Haven, went to La Jolla, went to the Vineyard. There are no ghosts like the ghost of New York theaters. So when we talk about Circle Rep,
yeah,
you know, whatever is there now, all of those ghosts of Circle Rep, Lamford Wilson,
yeah, Marshall,
all of the...
Well, Marshall's still with us.
But. Marshall is still with us, but all of those performances. And now that we're performing at the Court, we're performing on the stage where The Diary of Anne Frank began.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
So we can really feel the spirits. We felt the spirits at the Vineyard as well, which had been a Yiddish theater that's under the bones of the theater.
Now, why, when I hear you say ghosts, does that bring me to what Indecent's about?
Right. This play, Indecent, begins with the ghost of a theater troupe, a Yiddish theater troupe, coming back to life to tell us the story. And they're going to tell us the story about a ghost of a play that we are also trying to bring back to life, called The God of Vengeance, written by Sholem, Asch in 1907.
Yeah. Big hit in its day.
Huge hit all over Europe. I mean, controversial, the best kind of success that you want. Audiences flocked in Moscow, Odessa, Kiev, London. It came to New York. It was performed for over a decade down on the Lower East Side in Yiddish. It transfers uptown to the Village, which was uptown then.
Yeah.
and they translate it in English, and it's still a huge sold-out success. Someone gets the bright idea in 1922. Let's transfer this to Broadway. And the entire cast is arrested for obscenity on opening night. It's still kind of a footnote. This was the first production on the American stage where two women kissed on stage.
And that was the basis
of the obscenity charge?
Yeah. That was the obscenity charge. But the truth of the matter, if we look at God of Vengeance as something that's really a cultural, social, political event that becomes a perfect storm. There are all of these strands coming together in America. Anti-immigration, the KKK and white nationalism is on the rise. There is false news about the Jewish conspiracies in newspapers underwritten by Henry T. Ford. And of course, always, constantly, the sex trade, women in the sex trade, homophobia, homosexuality was extremely policed in this time. So add to all of this that in 1920, Congress is saying we have to stop letting immigrants into America. Mm. It was the first of very stringent refugee, anti-immigrant laws. And there are pogroms, massacres happening all over Europe. Mm-hmm. People are desperately trying to get to America. We kept them out and away. So it's an interesting time, regardless of how one feels about this past election. I got a phone call from my agent the morning after the election, and he said, how does it feel to have written one of the most pertinent plays in America right now? And I'm,
there's a part of you saying, he was elected president, it's going to be good at the box office.
It's, well, you know, we don't want to think that way, but here's what we're feeling very, very much, and we have all along. Which is, you know, I think of theater as the canary that you put into the coal mine. Mm-hmm. It tells us if there are poisonous gases. And that's what our theater does. That's what our music does. That's what our young writers do.
Maybe that's why they want to kill the NEA, so we won't see the dead canary.
Right.
But you were working on this play a long time before Trump was even thought of.
We have been working on this play 7 years ago, and I have to say, 7 years ago, one of the alarming things back then was the rhetoric against Muslims, the rhetoric against immigration. This election that we've just gone through did not come out of nowhere.
That's, we had Wally Shawn on a couple weeks ago, and he said the exact same thing about his play. He said, you know, Trump didn't come out of nowhere.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. So, you know, once again, since 1980, the Congress and politicians have been attacking the NEA. The NEA is not about endowing theater for people who can afford tickets. The NEA is about allowing accessibility to communities that can't afford tickets. Mm-hmm. We're going to be, once again, watching even greater cuts to school budgets. We're going to watch once again that there's a longer period of time before younger writers that we need to hear get through the gates of a diminishing number of theaters.
On that subject, I'm curious to know how you feel about, because you spent a lot of time in the nonprofit theaters.
Yes, all my life.
What's your feeling about Broadway ticket pricing these days?
My feeling about Broadway ticket prices right now is very much tied up with my feeling right now about philanthropy. Mm-hmm. One of the things that's changed in our cultural conversation, this too is part of the poisonous gas, is that we've lost generations of people who felt it was their obligation, if they made money, to make sure that there were public libraries, to make sure that they underwrote the cost of tickets. Now, there are still wonderful philanthropists doing it, but not to the extent that we had. Mm. One of the things that's really interesting about this, I uncovered interesting historical fact while writing Indecent that takes this journey from 1907 through the obscenity trial all the way to the beginning of the McCarthy period, mm-hmm. and the House on Un-American Activities.
The play did, yeah.
My play, Indecent, covers that whole swath. Yeah. And it looks at how do we as Americans suppress art and why. Why are we doing that, right? In the Loach ghetto in 1942, first they refused to let Jewish artists perform Aryan playwrights. But then they outlawed the doing of theater, period. Right. Because they thought nothing would so demoralize the population of the ghetto than to take theater away. And it's that notion and acknowledgement of these Jewish audiences that have vanished.
Yeah.
The importance of the culture and the theater. We need it right now. So I kind of see us again as going through this cycle of here we are at a perfect storm. Back in 1923, basically The God of Vengeance by Sholem, Asch was saying we are all lesbian, we are all Jews, we are all women. And now we have to say, right, not only are we all of these things, we are all Muslim. We're cycling back to a kind of separation of the American community in a very dangerous way.
Well, when the Nazis would have outlawed the performances at night. It is a way of fragmenting a community because
yes.
theater was so important to Jews, one of the few things they had left in the ghetto to come together.
Yes.
To take their mind off
yes.
the day-to-day horrors. You take that away, you're keeping everybody apart.
Right.
We should say that in that the original God of Vengeance also created a stir. I mean, it was written by this heterosexual, young, at the time, playwright, Sholem Asch, and it was about
a Jewish father.
A Jewish father.
And husband who is trying to raise a pure kosher daughter above the whorehouse that he runs.
And then the daughter falls in love with one of the prostitutes.
That's right. The daughter falls in love with one of the prostitutes. I mean, again.
And so he throws the Torah.
Kind of fun. This
1907.
Fun.
Know,
yes, right? Yes. And then he throws the Torah, and it's a whole wonderful.
I know, but you know, it's interesting. I've been down to the Tenement Museum, which I find really fascinating.
I love the Tenement
Museum.
You know,
we have this this wrong idea that people weren't having lots of sex and doing all that
kind
of
right.
stuff. That's right. This is 1907. The Lower East Side was teeming with poor people and immigrants and all
right.
of that kind of stuff.
Although,
he would have been in the center of it, and he would have been seen at all.
He right. falls in love with one of the prostitutes. I mean, it's beyond sex.
This is the thing that floored me. I read this play when I was 22 years old, my first year at Cornell. A professor looked at the way I was dressed and said, you should read God of Vengeance. And I thought, he's telling me something. So I run to the library, and I'm reading the play. I couldn't put it down. I come to the second act, and it's the most beautiful love scene between two women to this day. I have never read as beautiful a scene. And I kept flipping the pages thinking, a young newlywed man wrote this? It saw the love between the two women as spiritually akin to Romeo and Juliet on that balcony scene. It floored me. And the fact is that Europe at the time, all of the audiences loved the scene between the two women. They embraced it. So we have to also remember in these cycles, we didn't invent the wheel, right? This notion of a very fluid sexuality existed back in 1906.
And now we have a vice president who believes that you can lose your homosexuality through therapy.
Yes.
Did you?
And lobotomies.
Did you, in the course of your research, did you find any real people or anyone that he based the lesbian characters on? Did he?
No. However, the year before he wrote this, there was a huge riot in Warsaw in which the Bund, the socialist Jewish group, went in and attacked the pimps in all of the whorehouses for the working girls.
Yeah.
And so I don't think it's any accident that Sholem Asch wrote this the next year.
And he answered for it, too.
He answered for it.
Absolutely.
So no good play goes unpunished, you know?
We cannot stress enough how important it is that you go see Indecent by Paula Vogel. And it's a musical that you co-created with your director, Rebecca Teichman.
Yes.
We're listing it as a play, but it's really a very musical.
Singing and dancing lesbians.
Yeah. There are
it's about time. It's about time.
Singing and dancing. Hasim is like, come and see it. Hasidim, come see it. Yes.
Okay. Paula Vogel, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for being
here
on that theater talk.
Thank you.
Thanks.
There's one thing I know how to do. Make money. You are both paying me back on your backs, on your knees.
No!
Down into the whorehouse with you.
Help! He's gone crazy.
And take the Holy Spirit with you. I don't need him anymore.
On the northeast tip of North America, on an island called Newfoundland, there's an airport. And next to it is a town called Gander. Tonight, we honor what was lost, but we also commemorate what we found.
Now, Susan, there's a new show on Broadway, Come From Away, that
I
everybody's talking about.
It's terrific.
Well, it is an original musical, not based on a movie, not some old singer's catalog, back catalog of shows. From scratch, the only strike against it's not American, it's Canadian, but we'll take it here on Broadway. The show is written by Irene Sankoff and David Heinand, who are married.
Yep.
And Canadian.
He's dual, but yes.
Dual, all right. But directed by an American, Christopher Ashley. Welcome back to Theater Talk.
Great to be here.
All right, so guys, Come From Away, when I first heard about the show, everybody is calling it the 9/11 musical. That phrase might make some people say, whoa, a musical about 9/11. But that's not quite what it's about. Irene, can you give us a sense of what was on your mind when you decided to write it, what inspired it, and what it's about?
To quote Mr. Rogers' mother, she used to tell him, when you see scary things on TV, to look for the helpers, look for people who are trying to help, because there's always people trying to help. And that is basically what inspired us to go and talk to these people who took people off of planes. They didn't know who was on those planes. They took them off the planes, into their airport, into their towns. They stopped everything. So any community building was converted into a shelter.
So the people were coming off the planes because...
All the planes were grounded.
They're all grounded, yeah. Yes. So take a step back, yes.
38 planes and thousands of passengers that got sent to this tiny little town in Newfoundland, which is on the northeast edge of North America. And they were all welcomed into the town for 5 days, brought into the town halls, into the churches and the schools, and then taken from there into people's homes. They washed their clothes, they gave them showers, they fed them nonstop, and it changed people's lives. They made these lifelong friendships, people fell in love there, and it's this incredible story about kindness and generosity set against the backdrop.
And how did you hear about this story? Did you guys went up to the town and you interviewed the people before you started working on the show?
Yes, we did. We found out that there was going to be a commemoration ceremony, and people were going to return. People who still from 10 years ago had kept up these friendships, had sometimes gone back and forth to visit, and they wanted to go back one last time to honor everyone who had taken them in and to see their kids who are now 10 years older. Anyway, so we heard this was happening, and we got a grant from the Canadian government, and we got ourselves out there and in the thick.
So you were out there with your little tape recorders, just interviewing everybody?
Well, we were new to it. We started out trying to write down desperately, and then we figured out that our iPhones could actually record, and that helped a lot.
We needed to do that.
We should say there were almost as many people grounded from the planes as people in the town.
Yeah, the town's population practically doubled at the time.
It
was amazing. I mean, even on the 10th anniversary, when we came back, the town was filled with all of these people who had returned, but also with press who were looking for, these 5-second sound bites, and we didn't really know what we were looking for. So we ended up talking to people for 4 or 5 hours at a time, and then making friends with them, and then they invited us back to their house, and we got to stay there almost a month because we got to extend it because everyone said, don't be spending money on a hotel, just come stay at us. Here's the keys, feed the cats.
And this is where I'm going to take my next vacation. Right?
Yes.
And there's that feeling about the people that you've got in your show, Christopher. How big is the company of actors?
So we have 12 people playing the 7,000 people who dropped off there and the 9,000 people who lived in town.
Yeah. Your producers must love you. You're on a budget.
Yeah. It's one of the great things about working on this piece is these 12 actors have to transform and transform again on the dime.
How long have you been working on this production?
How did you find it? How did this come to you?
So my producing director out at La Jolla Playhouse, where I'm the artistic director, read for a reading series that they did a presentation of this, and she came into my office and she said, I'm not leaving until you read this play. It's extraordinary. And I fell in love with it really fast. I'm pretty jaded. So if you tell me this warm a story and my teeth don't ache, I think it's really good.
Did you always have the idea it was going to be a musical, or did you think maybe it'd be a play or?
I originally thought it should be something more like Laramie Project, where it's just the reaction a town has to a tragedy, and you're seeing bunches of different people, a little bit of 6 degrees of separation, moving quickly from scene to scene. And I was like, how is that going to be a musical?
Yeah, but I'd grown up on Newfoundland music and knew, music is in the DNA of the people out there. It's how they get through. They have these terrible, terrible winters, and it's freezing cold. And so the way they keep warm is everyone plays about 7 instruments each, and they bring their instruments over to each other's kitchens, and they tell stories, and they play songs.
Sounds a bit like Once, when they're all sort of depressed in the in the bar, and they do a jig.
It's similar, and it's how they keep warm, and it's how they've survived.
What is Newfoundland music, though? I mean, did they come get together and play like a Jerry Herman song, or indigenous music?
It's this incredible, unique, authentic, traditional music that, it's life affirming. It gets people dancing. We were out there on the 10th anniversary. This is when Irene realized it was...
He just kept saying to me, just wait until the music starts. When you hear the music, you'll see that this has to be a musical. And the band started playing. It was the Navigators. And it rocks. It's like Celtic rock.
And we have the band on stage. Yes. So the Balron and the fiddle are really a part, and the pipes are really a part of our life.
What struck you about this town when you went up there for the first time?
What David and Irene said is really right. Everyone takes care of you. I think I gained 5 pounds in 4 days. It's like you're constantly being fed. And everybody is a storyteller. And maybe it's the long winters, but everyone there tells their story with such humor and insight. So they would kind of tell us about the experiences of that week with incredible humor.
How big is that airport in that town? How could they take all those big planes? Some of them were big planes landing there?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
So the story of Gander was one of the things that first drew me in. It used to be one of the largest airports in the world. It was a refueling stop for World War II planes, both American and Canadian, that sent over to World War II. And then it became the crossroads of the world. That's what it's called, because everyone who had to travel across the Atlantic would stop there to refuel. So the Queen stopped there. It's where the Beatles first set foot in North America. Fidel Castro is well known for getting off his plane and going sledding with people there. And it was this incredible place where the world, no matter who you were, you stopped there. You had to get off your plane and hang out for a little while you refueled.
If you were a local on Saturday night, you would get yourself all dolled up and you'd go down to the airport bar and see who was coming through.
Yeah.
Right?
But then they invented jet engines and no one needed to stop there anymore. Yeah. And so they have this giant airport that, you know, got only a few flights a day since then. And then suddenly, after 9/11, the world...
That day, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wow, amazing. All right, well, the show is called Come From Away at the Schoenfeld Theater.
Yes.
And we have a little preview with Jenn Colella, who's in it, singing a beautiful song called Me in the Sky.
The wonderful, superb Jenn Colella. And this is sort of a big number of the show.
Right, yeah. Right. And it's written by David Heinand and Irene Sankoff and directed by Chris Ashley. And I'm telling you, everybody's talking about it. You know, everyone's, Jake Gyllenhaal's in this, and Glenn Close is in this one, all the stars of this, but everyone keeps telling me when they saw in Washington, D.C., keep your eye on Come From Away. It's going to topple everybody at the Tonys.
Okay, so Jenn Colella, take it away.
My parents must have thought they had a crazy kid, 'cause I was one of those kids who always knew what I wanted. They took me down to the airport to see all the planes depart, and watching them fly, something inside of me was starting. I was 8 when I told them that I'd be a pilot. But I was too young and too short, and there were no female captains. And my dad said, be patient, he said, just see what happens. But I took my first lesson, came down from the sky, and told my father I'd fly for the rest of my life. And I got my first job, flying for a mortician in a tiny bonanza, just a corpse and me, $5 an hour. Flying dead bodies, I had to climb over their faces just to get to my seat. Then suddenly the wheels lift off, the ground is falling backwards. I am suddenly alive. Suddenly I'm in the cockpit. Suddenly everything's changed. Suddenly I'm not too young or too short, and the passengers in the back don't complain. Suddenly I'm flying company charters. Suddenly everything's high. Suddenly there's nothing in between me and the sky. American Airlines had the prettiest planes, so I applied as a flight engineer. But the World War II pilots, they all complained. They said girls shouldn't be in the cockpit. Hey lady, hey baby, hey, why don't you grab us a drink? And the flight attendants weren't my friends back then, and they said, are you better than us, do you think? But I kept getting hired, and the World War II crew, they retired, and the girls all thought much higher of me. 1986, the first female American captain in history. Suddenly I'm in the cockpit. Suddenly I've got my wings. Suddenly all of those pilots protesting me, well, they can get their own drinks. Suddenly there's no one saying stay grounded, looking down, passing them by. Suddenly there's nothing in between me and the sky. Suddenly I've got an all-female crew. The news caught and made headlines across the world. Suddenly it's you won't, or you know you're not anything, 'cause you're a girl. Suddenly I'm getting married, and we're putting pins on the map where we've flown. Suddenly I am a mother, and suddenly shocked at how much they've grown. Suddenly I'm wondering how my parents would feel seeing me teaching men to be pilots, 'cause suddenly I am a senior instructor, and somehow I'm 51. Suddenly I'm flying Paris to Dallas, across the Atlantic and feeling calm, when suddenly someone on air-to-air traffic says at 8:46 there's been a terrorist action, and the one thing I loved more than anything was used as the bomb. Suddenly I'm in a hotel. Suddenly something has died. Suddenly there's something in between me and the sky.
I'm good, man.
Haven't seen you in a long time.
Yeah, it's good to see you.
Thanks for the mic. We're on a tight budget here, so we only get one. Jenn Colella singing Me in the Sky from Come From Away at the Schoenfeld Theater. Don't miss Come From Away at the Schoenfeld. Good night. We'll see you next time on Theater Talk.
Our thanks to the Friends of Theater Talk for their significant contribution to this production. Theater Talk is made possible in part by the Frederick Lowe Foundation, the Corey and Bob Dinelli Charitable Fund, the Noel Coward Foundation, Carrie J. Fries, the Dorothy Strelson Foundation, and the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs.
We welcome your questions or comments for Theater Talk. Thank you.